Assistant Attorney General Robert Havila is in private practice in Sturgis, South Dakota from 1985 to 2015. Of State's Attorney for Harding County, South Dakota from 1989 to 2015. He was also an adjunct political science professor for Black Hills State University from 2004 to 2015. He was also a football coach for the Meek County School District from 2001 to 2014, and is currently an assistant attorney general for the state of South Dakota. His emphasis is prosecution of illegal narcotic cases and major felonies, including homicides. He is a graduate of Black Hills State College in 1982, and is also a graduate of the University of South Dakota Law School. He is a member of the State Bar of South Dakota. Please give a warm welcome for Assistant Attorney General Robert Havila.
Well done. All right. First off, as we always say, can everyone hear me? Is it too loud? Is good? Okay, perfect. All right. Thank you for that introduction. She hit all the highlights. I'm not going to hit the lowlights. But I'm really happy to be back here. For those who don't know, I'm an Assistant Attorney General now, narcotics enforcement, along with major homicides here in Rapid City, and unfortunately, business is good. Sorry to say that. But one of the best things I've ever done is taught out here at Black Hills State University here in Rapid City. I have enjoyed it immensely. Someday I may try to get back to it. But it's just been nothing but a joy to teach. It's something I really enjoy. My father was a teacher. Dad taught Black Hills State, in those days, Black Hills State College, for 26 years before he passed away, a history professor. And my mother was a German national. Dad was with 2nd Armored Division after the war and met my mother. And that is why I have an interest in this area. I had two uncles that served in the Wehrmacht during the war. They were drafted. Those who don't know, the German Heer oder der German Deutsche Wehrmacht was the German army. And when you got your draft card, you didn't really have an option. And so they were two 18 and 19 year old boys that got drafted into the German army. And one of my favorite stories, I met my Uncle Bernie before he passed away. He was 19 years old, got his draft card into the German army. And like I say, you didn't get to argue about it, you went. And he was a machine gunner on the Western Front. And he told the story that he fought in the war, and finally they surrendered. And at the end of the war, most of the German, regular German army surrendered. I mean, they could read the writing on the wall, and they all surrendered. He surrendered to the Americans. And the Americans, in July of 1945, turned all the German POWs over to the French because the Americans were going home. So in July 1945, Uncle Bernie's transferred over to the French army. The French hated the Germans for reasons. I mean, there certainly was a reason there. But my uncle, who's a little guy, said one day he was told to carry another German soldier to the work where they were going to do their work, and he said that he couldn't do it. He was just too sick. The French officer said, fine, shoot him. So my uncle's telling me this in Germany. He said, they literally had me against the wall. And I'm standing there, and the French soldiers are loading their rifles. And I'm thinking, I've come through the war. I made it through. Now I'm going to get shot by the French? And he's standing there and, you know, thinking of his last moments. And an American officer came up and said, no, this man is a POW. The war is over. You're not shooting him. My uncle would say, I love the Americans. And he really did. He drove truck for the Allies then for 2 years afterwards. I could sing the Star Spangled Banner in English, and loved the Americans, and a lot of Germans felt that way at the end of the war. All right, let's talk about what we're going to talk about tonight. One of my favorite courses I taught when I was here was one on the Holocaust. Holocaust is very sobering, as you can well imagine. But I always challenged my students to not look at what you know now, but step back before the Holocaust occurred. We see Auschwitz and Buchenwald and Dachau. We see what happened there and the terrible things that happened there. But to understand how this happened, we got to step back before the rise of the Reich so we can understand, because a lot of people have difficulties with this. I mean, Germany is the land of Beethoven. Germany is the land of Goethe, of Martin Luther. I bet if I asked a show of hands in this room right now, how many have German ancestors? Yeah, because South Dakota, besides the Norse, besides the Norse, the Germans make up one of the largest ethnic groups that came in the 1900s and the turn of the century. So it's hard for us as individuals to say, how could this happen? I mean, this wasn't like in Cambodia or some faraway place where the culture was different. These were Germans. These were us. So how did it happen that millions of Jews, Russians, homosexuals were killed? How did this happen? By Germans and their allies. So that's what we're going to talk about. How did this all come about? I'm going to touch briefly at the end about the Holocaust. We have someone here who knows a lot more than I do. So if you ask a question I can't answer, I'm going to be going, you know, what's the answer? And she's going to tell you. Okay? All right. The other thing is, this has been billed as a lecture. It's not a lecture. This is a conversation. Okay? A lecture is something your dad did when you came in late on Saturday night. That's a lecture. This is a conversation. Anytime you want to ask a question, or anytime you don't understand something or can't hear me, just raise your hand and tell me. Okay? This is just a friendly conversation among friends. All right? All right. I enjoy talking about this. I've lectured on several classes at the high school level up in Sturgis, a couple other places, and I always tell people that to understand how Hitler came to power, you first have to understand Germany, Deutschland. Okay? There was no Germany for centuries. There was no Germany. It was Bavaria, Saxony, Rhineland. There are all these little principalities and kingdoms that made up the Germanic people. So there was no Germany as we know it today until the 1860s when Bismarck and the King of Prussia decided to unify Germany. And there's a series of wars among the proxy states of Germany, the kingdoms. There's unification. There was a war with Austria. But really, in 1871, when Germany defeats France in the Franco-Prussian War, that is really when we see the rise of modern Germany. Prussia unifies Germany under Otto von Bismarck and Kaiser Wilhelm I, who was actually the King of Prussia. They are unified into one country. Why is this important? Because it's important because this is now the start of German nationalism. Before that, there were the Bavarians and the Rhinelanders. But now there's this big push to make Germany a country. Deutschland über alles. That, you know, a lot of people hear that song, Deutschland über alles, and they think it means Germany all over the world. But actually, it comes from a poem that was meant to unite Germany. All Germans would come together. We would no longer be Bavarians and Rhinelanders. We would be one, Germany. So in the 1870s up to World War I, we see this period where Germany is really starting to unite. Okay? Plus, add to this, everyone knew in Europe in the late 1800s, there was going to be a war. Why? Because all the major countries were building up their militaries. Russia, France had the largest army in Europe. Germany was starting to expand into its colonies and building up its military. And then you had Britain. The British Navy was building. So everyone for the next, from 1870 up to World War I, knew there was going to be a war. The question was, when was it going to be? And what was going to happen? During this time also, the industrial age hit Germany. Germany went from strictly an agricultural country to one where you have the Ruhr Valley become one of the largest industrial areas in the world over a period of 20 years. So it had a lot of upheaval on the social side of things. Okay? Let's talk about the thing that starts the rise of Nazism, totalitarian, and to understand that, you have to understand World War I. Okay? So we have this rise of Germany, and everyone knows there's going to be a war, and it's going to take one spark to start it. And everyone knows what that was. Sarajevo. I tell people, again, to understand World War II, you got to understand World War I because of the effect it had on the German people. How does World War I start to begin with? World War I starts because you have all these countries building up their military, Russia, France, Britain, Germany, Austria, and they just need one spark to set off. And that spark came in June of 1914. Let's refresh our history a little bit. What happened in June of 1914? Good. Archduke Ferdinand, what happened? Got shot. Poor man got shot. Princip, yep. Okay. The poor man got shot. It all started because what had happened was Bosnia, modern-day Bosnia, was part of the Austrian-Hungarian Empire. Austria had annexed it about 10 years before. Bosnia and Serbia did not, Serbia was an independent country, did not like being part of the Austrian-Hungarian Empire. They were actually nationalists. So in June of 1914, Archduke Ferdinand, who was the nephew of the emperor, decided he would go to Sarajevo, picked a bad time to go because it's a very important national holiday in Serbia, the country next door, decided to go inspect the army in June of 1914. He was told, don't go. In fact, his intelligence agency, don't go down there. Number one, it's a national holiday in that area. Number two, they really don't like us, okay, because we're occupying their country. And we really think you shouldn't go. Archduke Ferdinand, you had to know the man, he was the commander of the Austrian military. He believed in absolute right of kings, and he says, I am going. I am the commander of the Austrian army. I will inspect the Austrian army, and I will not kowtow to any type of nationalists or terrorists or anything else. Okay? He goes on train, leaves, takes his wife with him down to Sarajevo, arrives in Sarajevo on June 28, 1914, goes in, and on their way in, they had a caravan going to City Hall. He's going to give a speech at City Hall, and the mayor was going to welcome him, do that kind of thing. On the way in, there were seven assassins in the city that day. Seven. Okay? There were seven assassins in town in Sarajevo that day. Archduke Ferdinand's convoy goes to City Hall. On the way in, someone throws a bomb. Now, it doesn't get Archduke Ferdinand, but it got the car behind him. And if you remember in those days, the old Model Ts were all open. Okay, it hits that car and injures some individuals. Now, this is going to come back to haunt him. They get to the City Hall. The mayor says, you know, you really need to leave. We know there are terrorists here. We think they're Serbian ties. You need to go back to Austria. Archduke Ferdinand gives a speech, and he says, you know, well, maybe you're right. Let's just head back down to the train station. We'll go, Sophie and I, his wife, was his wife's name, we'll go back to Austria and we'll call it good. They're driving down the road, and in Sarajevo, the road going down to the train station, it goes by the river. So obviously they call it the river road. They're going down the river road, and Archduke Ferdinand tells his driver, you know, before we go, I would like to go to the hospital and see those people who got injured this morning. You know, it'd be the right thing to do. I'm in the Archduke Ferdinand. And the driver says, okay, I can do that. We'll turn and go to the hospital. So the driver comes up on the river road, takes a right to head to the hospital, suddenly realizes he's made a mistake. The hospital's the other way. So he starts to turn the car around. And if you've been in Western South Dakota, you know, I do a five-point turn. You kind of turn a little and turn a little to get the car turned around. Okay. There were seven assassins in town that day to kill the Archduke Ferdinand. Okay, seven. Police arrested six of them. One guy had tried to throw a bomb, they caught him. Another pulled a gun, and as he pulled a gun, police arrested him. So they had gotten them all but one. The driver is now turning the car around, and he stops. Guess where he stopped? One of the most cruel turns of history. He stopped right in front of the seventh assassin who hadn't been arrested yet. Princip was his name. Princip walks up, sees Sophie, shoots her first. She takes two shots to the chest. She collapses. He then walks up to Archduke Ferdinand, shoots him twice, gets him in the neck once in the chest, and he collapses. His last words are, oh my God, what will happen to our children? They try to get him to the hospital. Princip is arrested, but it's too late. He bleeds out on the way to the hospital. So he's dead. The heir to the Russian, or excuse me, the Austrian throne has just been killed. Now we might say, okay, that's terrible. His wife's dead too. We understand that. But how did this start the war? I mean, my goodness, there are millions of people killed in this war. How did this start? Because of a dead Archduke. Terrible thing, but why? It's very simple. Austria demands that there be an answer given as to how this happened. Austria suspects that Serbia, the country next door, had a hand in it. Because everyone who was arrested were Serbian nationals. They demand that an investigation begins. And actually, Serbia didn't object. Yep, you come down here. We'll assist you in it. We want to get to the bottom of it too. Austria made another demand. Not only will we be allowed to go into Sarajevo, which was part of the Austrian Empire, we're going into Serbia too. We're going into your country, and we're going to investigate, and we're going to find where this goes. And Serbia says, can't do that. We can do anything else, but we can't do that. There was a reason Serbia said that. You know why the Serbian government said that?
Guess the Balkans are always fighting each other.
True. Guess where the guns and money came from? Serbian intelligence agencies, their fingerprints were all over this assassination. They had provided the guns, they had provided the money, and they provided the training for the assassins. That's why Serbia really didn't want Austria coming in, because if they start running the checks, they're going to find out that it goes pretty high in the Serbian Foreign Office. That's why they refused. Austria gives them an ultimatum. Austria says that if you don't let us in to investigate, we're going to declare war. Serbia tried to negotiate and tried to work something out, but they really couldn't do it because it went so high up in the government. Bottom line is Austria declares war on Serbia in July of 1914. Okay, so now you got two Balkan countries fighting each other. It's not the first time this has happened, right?
Where
I asked. Serbia looks to Russia. Russia and the Tsar were the protector of the Slavs in the Balkans. That's what they called themselves. Excuse me. They were to protect the Slavs, the Serbs. So Serbia turns to Russia, and of course I'm making this pretty simple. But they say, hey, the Austrians are mobilizing, they're attacking, and they start shelling the capital. Will you back us up? Russia says, absolutely, we are the protectors of the Slavs. We have a treaty with your country. We will back you up. They tell Austrian, quit it, simplifying things, quit it or we will mobilize our troops. What does Austria do? Austria turns to Germany, to the Kaiser and says, we have a treaty with you, mutual defense treaty. Yes, we do. If Russia mobilizes, and for those who don't know, mobilization is back in the old days when you want to get your army to go to war. It took you about 3-4 weeks to get everyone put together and get all the supplies and get that. Russia's mobilizing. If Russia mobilizes, Germany, will you protect us? Germany says, well, absolutely. We have a mutual defense treaty. I will. We will. Germany will protect you. What do the Russians say? They find that out. They go to France. They had a treaty with France. Okay, did you know that the Germans are backing the Austrians who are attacking the Serbs, who we are backing? France, do you have a treaty with us, mutual defense treaty? Will you back us up? France says, absolutely. If Germany starts to mobilize, get their army together, okay, we'll back you up. We will not stand for it. That's a violation. You are threatened. We will back you up. We will adhere to the treaty, and we'll come to your aid.
That was referred to as entangling alliances.
Yeah, and here's the weird thing. Talk about entangling alliances. Most of the king of Tsar of Russia, Kaiser Wilhelm of Germany, and King George, who's going to come in just a second, they're all cousins. They're all first or second cousins. I tell you what, I've been to some family reunions, but this is crazy. Britain really didn't, they technically didn't have a treaty with anyone. They had some loose treaties with France, but nothing really concrete said they had to come into the war. But Britain's fear was of the German Navy. If you understand English history, the Navy is it. I mean, the British Navy, Britannica rules the waves. And they feared German Navy expanding. Germany had already done some expansion, we talked about earlier about the military's expanding. So by August of 1914, we've got a world war. We've got France, England, and Russia on one side, Germany, Austria, Austria-Hungary Empire on the other. So what's come from a little Balkan fight is now world war. When you go to Germany, if you ever go to Germany, and I encourage you to do so, because Germans love Americans, as long as you speak two words of German. Okay. Every village has a World War I memorial because the millions of people who died in that war in Germany. Every little village has a World War I memorial. I've traveled through Germany with my family, and it does amaze me that, yeah, every one of them. You don't have any World War II monuments, but they got a whole lot of World War monuments because the way it affected the German people. Everyone knew someone who was killed in that war. The World War I was one of those wars where you had outdated methods fighting a modern war. You still had these masses of troops attacking fortifications, trenches, and we had machine guns and grenades, things that could just destroy waves upon waves of people. So what happens in World War I, especially in Germany and France to a degree, is that everyone had somebody they had lost in World War I. It was trench warfare. It was murder at its best. You would attack a trench, you would take that trench, you would lose in the Somme when they lost 160,000 soldiers and gained 5 miles because of their outmoded methods trying to attack modern facilities. In fact, it became at one point where the strategy in the war was to make your enemy attack you and you'd sit there and shoot them when they come in. That's how bad the war was. The other thing that was affecting Germany was the Brits had put a very good naval blockade on. So the civilian population in Germany by 1918 was starting to starve. It was getting very hard on these civilians. The German high command knew this. Even though they kept putting out news of we're winning the war and we're going to march through Paris, because in those days you march through Paris, you won the war. Kind of ridiculous. But they kept putting out the propaganda. The German war machine kept saying, we are winning World War I. We are going to win. But inside the command, Hindenburg, who was the general-in-chief, and Ludendorff were concerned. War was not popular anymore. Okay? The August 1914, where everyone was saying, boy, we're going to go win the war, it was over. By 1918, Germany was in trouble. And Ludendorff and Hindenburg, the generals, knew that. They also knew that the Americans were coming in, if you remember your history. 1917, we declare war on Germany. By 1918, the German high command is very concerned that the Americans are going to come in. Okay? The German generals decide we're going to make one big thrust in the spring, 1918. We're going to push. This is it. We're going to push, we're going to break through the lines, and we're going to get to Paris. We're going to gamble everything. Okay, this is the spring of 1918. They don't want the Americans coming in lines. We had troops there, but not like they feared they would. So in the spring of 1918, the Germans do the last offensive, and they push hard. And they come close, but they don't get there. By August 1918, German army starting to surrender. Now that's unheard of. And the generals know that that's unheard of. And they go to Kaiser Wilhelm and they say, you know what? The German army's starting to surrender. And thousands of German troops are throwing down their arms. They'd have enough. They say to the Kaiser, we've got to talk peace because we can't hold this out much longer. By August, we've lost so many troops, we don't have a German army. Kaiser Wilhelm agrees that they should at least start talking an armistice. The generals contact the Allies make it clear the only way we're going to have an armistice if the Wilhelm abdicates, Kaiser Wilhelm abdicates, gets off the throne. In October, Ludendorff and Hindenburg have another conference with the Kaiser. You've got to abdicate. The Kaiser says, I will not abdicate. we can win this war. He says, no. Hindenburg, who's later lies about it, says, no, we cannot win this war. You've got to abdicate. Long story short, November 1918, we have an armistice. The Kaiser abdicates, goes to Holland, and there is an armistice signed. Now, what's an armistice? Go ahead.
I'm sorry for interrupting.
No. When he takes power, he'll talk about the November Kremlis, and he'll talk about something else that's called the Dolchstoss, which is the stab in the back. And this is why I wanted to talk about what the army propaganda was saying. Remember, they keep saying, we're going to win this war, we're going to win this war. The German public believes it. The generals know, we ain't going to win this war, we ain't going to win this war. We'll come back to that. Good point. So, what happens? We have an armistice on November 11, 1918. The war ends, but the war doesn't end. It's an armistice, right? You have to have a treaty to actually end the war. So now we begin treaty negotiations in Paris, at Versailles. The Allies were going to get the revenge on Germany. They produced to them a treaty which basically said, look, number one, the German army said 100,000, which, for those who know the army, that's not very much. Two, you're going to spend over $3 billion in damages, reparations, fancy term. So you got to pay, you have 100,000 men in your army, you got to pay $3 billion in reparations. Here's the one that really, really got to the Germans. Article 231 of the treaty. It's called the War Guilt Clause. In the treaty, the Allies said, Germany, it's your fault you started the war. Germany's going, what? What about the Austrians and the Serbs? And remember all that stuff? That? It's your fault. You started the war. Now, it doesn't seem like that would be a stumbling point maybe in modern eyes, but to a nationalistic country that's only 40 years old who didn't really start the war, that was a bitter pill. So what happened? The German parliament said, we will not accept that treaty. The Hebert, the prime minister, said, we will not accept that treaty. The German public said, we will not accept that treati. Gerald von Hindenburg met with the parliament and the prime minister said, you're going to accept that treaty. Why? It was a diktat. The Germans call it a diktat, dictated terms. Why are you going to accept the treaty? Because the general says, you don't have an army. You don't understand. If you don't accept this treaty, you don't have an army to stop the Allies. The Allies will march right into Berlin, and there's nothing we can do about it. We're done. You don't understand. Our army surrendered back in August of 1918. We're done. Now, he's going to deny this later. He said that. But it's true. He told the Prime Minister, members of Parliament, you've got to accept the treaty. And in June 1919, the Germans accepted the treaty. One thing about that treaty, everyone hated it. Whether you're a communist, a conservative, it didn't matter. You hated that treaty, especially the war guilt part. So the treaty was accepted. The war's over. So now what do? We have to come up with a government. Remember, the Kaiser abdicated, right? We really don't have a government. The king's gone. So we have to come up with a government. What they decide to do is come up with a republic in Weimar, Germany. Why Weimar, not Berlin? Because Berlin, it was thought, was too radical. There was a lot of communists in Berlin at the time. And so they decided to have the capital of the new government be in Weimar, which is south-central Germany. Okay? The Weimar government, the constitution, it was, compared to what they had, even the United States at the time, was a very liberal constitution, very liberal. The constitution guaranteed suffrage for women. I always point this out. Before the United States did it, the Germans did it. Women had the right to vote. The Constitution had some strange things to it. For example, if you had 60,000 votes, you could go out and get 60,000 votes, you could be in Parliament. That was one thing, because it ensured that you'd never have too strong of a party running the government, which changes, of course. The other thing was a very strange thing called Article 48. And Article 48 in the new German Constitution said, in times of emergency, the president can suspend the Constitution. In other words, he can take away all constitutional rights in times of emergency. Now, this is going to play in later, But that was one of the little weird things in that constitution. All right? Okay, so we now have the Weimar government in place. It is a time when there a lot of people are upset. This is a time when a lot of people think we got stabbed in the back, the Dolchstoss, because the military said, we're winning the war, and what happened? We lost the war. Okay, so there's a lot of groups around Germany at that time, small groups that are getting together in beer halls, and I always tell people beer halls are not what you think they are. They aren't bars. They're like the Holiday Inns and stuff. We have meeting rooms and stuff. And they decide that they're going to get together. People are starting to grumble about this treaty, how we were treated. And, of course, it was the Jews' fault, right? The Juden. They were the ones, the politicians and the Jewish politicians that stabbed us in the back. We won the war, and the troops would have won it, but they got stabbed in the back. So you have a lot of these little groups forming around. And some of them decided to become a political group. One of these was called the Deutsche Arbeiterpartei, the German Workers' Party. A little group of guys in Bavaria, in Munich, and they would get together and they would sit around and, you know, I hate this treaty and, you know, geez, you know, it's the Jews' fault, right? Because Great Germany fell because they got stabbed in the back by the Jewish politicians. And they'd sit around and gripe about it. Drink beer and gripe, right? We do the same thing now, but it's after the Packers have lost, so we're not going there. I'm not bitter. Yes? It really wasn't, but and we'll talk about anti-Semitism here in a second. During this time, there's a lot of conspiracy theories going on. One of the conspiracy theories, believe it or not, was that there had been a meeting in Switzerland in the late 1890s where this great Jewish congregation had gotten together and decided to take over the world through financing. That's how they were going to do it. And a lot of people believed it. What's that? The Protocol of the Elders of Zion. A lot of people believed it. I mean, they thought, you know, here was this book, supposedly the minutes of the meeting and all this. Well, it was actually a fraud. The Tsar's police had cooked this whole scheme up. Fake news, exactly. Good way to put it. It was fake news. But people believed it. So if someone just happened to be Jewish and a politician, well, there you go. There's your conspiracy theory right there. So yes, there was a lot of conspiracy theories going on. Plus, in 1919, and for the next 5-6 years, there's a lot of trying to overthrow the government because the Weimar Republic was so weak. You had putsches on the right where they're trying to overthrow the government. The communists held Berlin for about a year. So you have a lot of this going back and forth, and there are a lot of people unhappy about the way things went. One of this group was the DAP, the Deutsche Arbeiterpartei, DAB, German Workers' Party. And they decided they wanted to become a political party. They were a bunch of guys, get together, gripe a little in the fall of 1919, and they decided to become a party. Now, under German law at the time, if you wanted to become a party, you had to be inspected by the police. What they would do, they'd send a police out, and he'd go up and say, okay, I'm going to put your name and write all this stuff down and listen to you what you had to say. Because this is Bavaria, Munich, the army was the police. They had declared martial law sometime before, so the army is the one who's going to go out and send the officer out and do all this stuff. So they send this corporal out. And he goes out to the meeting in the fall of 1919, and he's, okay, let's see, anti-Semitic. And he listened to the speeches and wrote all these notes down, actually participated in a little bit about it in the meeting, and came back and said, you know, here's my report. Okay? Now everyone knows who the corporal was. Adolf Hitler. Adolf Hitler did not was not a founder of the German Nazi Party. Two guys named Drexler and Harauer. But he went out there in September of 1919, in the fall of 1919, and he's the one that inspected it for the army. And he was about to get mustered out, about to lose his job in the army because they were cutting down on the army. He saw an opportunity here. He kind of made some notes. You know, I can't agree with a lot of what they're saying here. They're nationalistic. They don't like the Weimar government. And they are anti-Semitic, and everyone knows the Jews did it. Okay? And when I say this, please understand my sarcasm. Okay? But Hitler becomes member 555. He leaves the army then, gets mustered out, and he joins this small German workers' party. Right, let's talk a little bit about Adolf Hitler. Everyone knows he wasn't German, right? He was born in Austria, just across the river from Germany, a little village called Braunau am Inn. His father was Aloysius. His mother was Clara Pell. Interesting story. There were a lot of rumors in the Third Reich that Hitler was Jewish. I'm sure probably you have probably heard that story before. The reason Hitler was Jew, or they claimed Hitler was Jewish, is that Hitler's father, Aloysius, was illegitimate. Hitler's grandmother, Maria Schickelgruber, was a maid in a household in Vienna. The household was run by a very rich Jewish banker. Maria becomes pregnant. We don't know who the father is. Maria leaves the service of her employer, and the employer continued to pay her money after her child was born. A lot of historians say, aha, child support. Not really. It wasn't uncommon at all for an employer. If they had a good employee, they would sometimes support them after they left just because it was the right thing to do. So we really don't know whether Maria Schickelgruber, who was Hitler's grandmother, we really don't know who the father of her child was. We do know that there were enough rumors going around in the Third Reich that when Hitler comes to power, she was buried in Germany, he turned the graveyard into an artillery range and blasted the heck out of her grave. So there were a lot of rumors about that. Hitler's dad, Aloysius Hitler, was in Austria, lived on Braunau. He was a customs official, so if he came across the border, he's the one that would check the wagons and make sure all the customs were paid. He was a very mean man. Most of the accounts that we have that Hitler's father was, he almost beat Hitler to death one time. Came very close to killing him when Hitler was about 10. Could be argued, I suppose, he would have done the world a favor, but that's not the way to think. Hitler's father drank heavily. He was one of these guys, get off work, go home, drink for about 4 hours, and then come home. Hitler and his dad were not very close. Hitler's dad, Aloysius, wanted young Adolf, to be a customs official, like he was. Hitler didn't want to be a customs official. This is one of those teenage father things that are going on here. Hitler wanted to be an artist. Hitler's mother, Clara, really fostered her son to be an artist. Hitler, I've seen some of his pictures, he could paint landscapes and watercolors, and he was good enough that he did apply to the Vienna Academy of Fine Arts. He applied in 1907, and they've gone back and looked at the logs, and after they did the testing, Hitler did his testing, they found in one of the logs where it says, and I quote, "The following test was insufficient, results are not admitted. Adolf Hitler, Braunau am Inn, April 21st, 1889, date of birth. German, Catholic, father, civil servant, 4 classes in high school, few heads, test drawing, unsatisfactory." Hitler couldn't draw people. Now, I always tell the psychology majors in the class, what does that mean? There's got to be something there. Hitler's dad dies in 1903. Hitler was recommended to attend architecture school. He didn't want to do that.
Well, Madame Schickelgruber married a guy named Heidler.
Which was anglicized to Hitler. Yeah. Aloysius' stepfather.
I saw the name transfer.
Right. A big turning point came in 1908. Clara Pell dies of breast cancer on December 21st. I'm not saying Hitler was a mama's boy, but he was very close to his mother. She's the one that fostered him. She's the one that encouraged his interest in the arts. And when she dies, Hitler kind of falls apart. Goes to Vienna. Vienna in those days, it was the modern art scene of Europe, 1908 in those times. I always call it the Haight-Ashbury, if those of us who remember the 60s. I was just a kid. I just heard about it. But the Haight-Ashbury of Europe at that time. A lot of flop houses, people, you know, artist type. Hitler's, it's interesting, Hitler's job, besides painting pictures, he'd go out and he'd beat carpets. And what you would do in those days was you didn't have, most people didn't have wall-to-wall carpet like we have now. They had big area rugs. And they didn't have vacuum cleaners. So what you would do is take the rug out, put it on the line, and beat it to get the dust out. That's what Hitler did. That's what he did for a job. Lived in flop houses. And then he also heard a lot about more anti-Semitism. The mayor of Vienna at that time was a very, very anti-Semite and would give long lectures about anti-Semitism. Then in 1913, Hitler leaves Vienna. He decides to join the German army because he didn't want to serve in the Austrian army. Remember I said everyone knew there was a war coming. It's just a question of when. So he joins the Bavarian army, and in 1914, he goes into active service. Hitler was a runner. Anyone know what that is?
Yeah.
Right. He was, before we had the days of wireless radio, and they did have some crude telephone lines, but they were always getting cut. If you wanted the general to get a message from the front lines, you give it to a runner, and he'd take off and run back to the headquarters, give the message, and then come back. Very dangerous work. Why? Because the other side knows who you are. And they're not going to let that message get through. Hitler was decorated twice for valor, received the Iron Cross. Most of the soldiers who served with Hitler in World War I said he wasn't a bad soldier, actually did his duty, but don't get him talking about politics. Because he would just go off on German nationalism and how this was all the Jews' fault, et cetera, et cetera. But he did do his job.
I thought you were going to address this. Wasn't either his grandmother or his mother buried in Israel?
I don't know that for a fact. No, the grandmother wasn't. Because he blew up the cemetery where she was. I don't know about the mother.
I read somewhere that
okay. It sure could have been.
Yeah.
By no, Maria's wasn't.
And he went and visited
there. Hitler did?
Yeah.
I don't know that for a fact, but I'm not saying it's not true. I haven't heard that. It's possible.
Well, it wasn't Israel, so it
would have been Palestine at that time. It was under a British protectorate. Okay, good, good. Again, anyone's got anything to add, please jump in. Okay. Hitler was then injured during a gas attack on October 13, 1918. That is where he first finds out about the treaties, in a hospital bed, lying in a hospital bed. And he said in Mein Kampf, it was the darkest day of my life when I heard that the November Kremlists had stabbed us in the back and had surrendered. Okay. That gives you a little bit about Adolf Hitler. Okay. He joins the German Workers' Party then in 1919. For the most part, they were a flake group. Most people regarded them as kind of an off-to-the-right wacko group. I think that's the term we use now, wacko, wackadoodles. Okay, they were a bunch of wackadoodles. Okay, from 1919 on, the German Workers' Party had problems. Money was a big one. I mean, how do you keep raising money? Sure, you can complain and complain and complain, but you know, at some point, how do you get money raised? How are you going to become a serious political party? Well, events start to turn in German history at this point to give rise to the German party. All right. Let's first talk about some of the events that gave rise and enabled the Workers' Party to get powerful. One. As I said earlier, after 1919, we had a lot of governments trying to overthrow the Weimar government. The Weimar government was very weak. Remember, anyone gets 60,000 votes gets to be in parliament, right? Well, that means you have a lot of different people in there and no strong groups. In the fall of 1922, the Weimar government decided that they would try to do something that would change, actually, the history of Germany. What had happened was, remember they had paid all the damages from World War I? Well, France got ticked because they weren't getting paid, so they seized factories in the Ruhr Valley. So they seized them. They haven't paid your money. We're going to take them. So the German government in 1922 and into 1923 said, okay, here's what we're going to do. You workers in the Ruhr Valley where the French took you, took the factories, go on strike. And you know what we're going to do? We're going to print money. We're going to print money so you get paid. Well, the German economy was all inflationary. Most economies after war, during war, are inflationary economies. In other words, you print a lot of money because you got to pay a lot of bills. So the government started printing money, lots of money. And in 1923, the inflation takes off. The economic woes in Germany begin. It was a nightmare. I've got some figures here to give you an idea. To give you an example of German inflation, 1923, remember, the government's going to start printing bills, support the strikers. Germany, in the early 1920s, $1 would buy 100 marks. So your exchange rate was 100 marks, $1. Okay? On January 1st, 1923, a dollar would buy 18,000 marks. On July 1st, 1923, $1 would buy you 160,000 marks. On August 1st, 1923, $1 would buy you 1 million marks. On November 1st, 1923, this is the one I've seen these bills too, $1 would buy you 4.2 billion marks. And the numbers just kept on and on. It was not unusual to see a 10 billion mark note, 10 with a B. There's a gentleman up in Sturgis who was in the Germany after the war, he found a bunch of these notes. And I keep saying, you know, I'd really like to have some of these so I could educate people like you. And he won't give them to me. During this time, the economic problems were terrible. Think about it. Life savings wiped out. You might have had $2,000 in the bank. It isn't worth anything now. And the government still allowed banks to print notes. You've seen the pictures where money on sheets, literally on sheets, printing it on sheets to try to keep up. Let me give you an example of what it was like in Germany in those years. Germans got paid, the German worker got paid 3 times a day. So you go in the morning and you get paid. And you bring your child or your wife with you and you say, okay, here's the money, run to the bakery and get some brot. Grab the bakery and get some broke. Get paid at noon. Again, you bring your wife and child with you to work, or they'd come to work, you say, here's the money. Go buy it first. And they'd run to the sausage because the money was going to be worthless by the time you got there. And you got paid about 4 o'clock in the afternoon. By then, the money markets had closed, the international money markets had closed, but your money was worthless. That's how crazy it got. People were starving to death because they couldn't pay enough money to get enough food. Okay? That was in 1923. In 1923, our friend Adolf Hitler decides that it's time for him to come into action. Remember the German Workers' Party? Now it's the NSDAP, the National Socialist Deutsche Arbeiterpartei. Germans love long words. Have you ever noticed that? The Nazis. That's what we call the Nazis, the NSDAP. They've changed the name. And now he decides it's time for me to make a move. So what does he do? He came up with this brilliant idea, Adolf. He decides he's going to march on Munich. Him and the Nazis are going to take over the Bavarian government. We're going to march on Munich. Okay? So on November 8, 1923, the governor of Munich, what we call a governor, is giving a speech, and in rocks Hitler and the Nazis. This is, if you ever heard the Beer Hall Putsch, this is what we're talking about. He comes in, the governor's giving a speech, Hitler jumps up on a desk, shoots a revolver into the air, and says, the revolution is on. Everyone's kind of like, what the heck? They take the governor hostage and basically say, you know, you're one of us now, right? And the governor, oh yeah, I'm one of you, you bet. You got the revolver, you bet I'm one of you. And all night, the Nazis tear down places, break into shops, bars. It's chaos. The next morning, Hitler rounds up all his Nazis, about 1,500 of them, and they're going to march on the center of town and take over Munich. And then they're going to go on to Berlin. Okay? They start marching down the streets. Have you ever been to Munich? The streets are very narrow in Munich, in the old town. Marching down the streets. Get to the center of the city. Wait a minute. Where's the governor? I don't know where the governor is. I thought you had the governor. I don't have the governor. Where's the governor left them. They get to the center of town, and guess what? There's the governor with all the police and the army, and they fire on the Nazis. Hitler had to dive to the ground. He didn't get shot, but he dislocated his shoulder. A couple of other head Nazis got shot. Hermann Göring got wounded. He fled. A couple others, eight of them were killed. But Hitler's arrested and charged with treason. It was treason. Now, in March 1924, Hitler's tried for treason. This is a charge that he could have been shot for. Treason against the German government. Okay? He decides he's going to trial. I'm going to trial. His lawyer said, don't go to trial. We can work a deal. No, I'm going to trial. So they go to trial in March 1924. Big headlines all around Germany. Hitler goes to trial. Going to defend himself. Hitler gets to the stand. His lawyers get him on there. And being a lawyer, I know how this goes. Hitler won't shut up. Hitler gets on the stand. I mean, understand, this man could be shot for what he did, right? Treason. Hitler gets on the witness stand. Won't shut up. He gets up there and he says, if trying to save Germany from these November criminals is treason, then I am guilty. If trying to save Germany from the Dachstuhls and the Jews, then I am guilty. It goes on for hours. For an hour and a half, 2 hours. His lawyers are trying to shut. He won't shut up. What Hitler had done was he knew that he was guilty. I mean, you can't get away from the evidence. But he tries to make it into a political speech and does a very good job. By the end of his speech, his testimony, the German prosecutor and the judges, in Germany you have three judges and I believe it's two lay people are your juries. They still do it that way. They apologize to Hitler. They say, Herr Hitler, we're sorry. I understand you had good intentions, but you're guilty. And I've been a prosecutor for almost 3 years. I have never apologized to a defendant, and I will not. But they apologized to Hitler. Hitler is found guilty in March 1924, and in April, sentenced to 5 years in prison. It's going to be cut back to 1 year. In a minimum security facility. He could have been shot. Probably should have been shot. But he was not. Okay. Hitler tries to take over the government. Doesn't work. It fails. The Germans do get their act together. And the 1920s was not a good time for the Nazis, quite honestly. After Hitler gets out, the golden 20s in Germany, the economy was booming. Hitler was kind of pushed to the side. The Nazis were kind of pushed to the side. The party suffered. I mean, they weren't making money. Times were good. We don't want to hear all that baloney about the November criminals, right? Times are good. But something happens. 1929. Everyone knows what happened in 1929, in the fall. Yep, stock market crashes. Now, what you have to understand is, it's okay, it's just hot air. It happens. 1929 stock market crashes in the United States. Depression starts. The Germans had borrowed a lot of money from the Americans, mostly short-term notes, to keep their social policy, a lot of social programs to keep them going. They borrowed from the Americans a lot of money. So what happens in 1929 when the stock market closes or crashes? The Americans come to the Germans. Say, excuse us, but you owe us money on notes. We're calling the note. The German government couldn't pay it because they were so tied into the American economy. When the American economy collapses, the bankers from America come to the Germans and say, we want our money. We want it now. Germans said, we can't pay that. Well, then we're going to foreclose. We're going to take what we can. That causes the German economy to collapse. right now. What did I say in the 1920s about the Nazis? From 1925 on. Bad time for the party, right? Good times are coming, man. Everyone's doing well. What happened to the Nazi party? 1929, everything collapses. And all of a sudden, people are looking around. I've lost my job. Into 1930, gosh, this isn't fair. There must be someone who can take over this and do something right, right? And who was standing there going? The Nazis. The Nazis in 1930 began the real push to power. You know, remember, they were just kind of this flaky group in the 1920s. But now it's 1930. Unemployment rate skyrockets. Financial institutions are collapsing. And the Nazis said, you know, listen to us. We can take care of this problem. So in 1930, the Nazis really start to push. It's interesting. You know, the Nazis, I always pointed out, were the first party to get it. In that, as a political party, they never went away. Starting in 1930, there are several elections. Nazis never quit campaigning. They kept going. You know, most parties, you have an election, you campaign, then once the election's over, you kind of go away. Kind of like we do. Not with the Nazis. And starting in 1930, they start pushing hard. They start setting up committees. They start, Hitler had a good part of this, setting up committees to find out what kind of propaganda works, what kind of songs work, what kind of, you know, colors should we have. These little committees would report back to Berlin. Or to Munich, which was party headquarters. The Nazis got it. And they start pushing things. The Nazis start pushing things. In 1930, they start to grow. And it made no sense what they were saying. For example, I'll give you a good example. The second command of the party, a guy named Gregor Strasser, is interviewed. And they say, you know, how can you say this? You say that you're going to give Bavarian farmers top money for their crops, right? And Strasser says, yeah, we're going to do that. But you just told the Berlin housewives that you're going to cut the groceries prices. How do you do that? And any time Strasser was cornered, because there were a lot of journalists, especially from America, saying, how does this work? You can't tell this guy you're going to get money for your product and tell this guy you're going to lose money, right? You can't do that. It doesn't work. And the response of Strasser and all the Nazis, including Hitler, was, the will of the German people will make it work. The German people will come together and they will make this work. Very nationalistic, very verbose, but they were going to make it work. And so what happens? Starting in 1930, we see the growth of the party. We see that it is by 1932, the elections of 1932, this is the second largest party in Germany. It's an interesting statistic. Yes, by the 1932 elections, the Nazis are the number two party in the parliament. In fact, by 1930, they had 107 seats in parliament. Second largest party in Germany. But they could never get the majority of the party. They were never a majority. A lot of people don't understand that. Is that even though the Germans were the second largest, the Nazis were the second largest party in Germany, they were never the largest party in Germany. They couldn't get a majority in parliament. So by 1930, they're sitting there in parliament, they're the second largest party, but they can't come to power. They've got to figure out a way to come to power. And in 1930, 31, and 32, they will come to power. All right. I need a drink of water. How are they going to come to party power? I mean, again, they are the second largest party in Germany, but they don't have a majority in parliament. So how are they going to do this? Hitler has a meeting with the head members of the party because they've got good growth. I mean, you know, 6 million people are in the party now. What are we going to do? Number one, they decide to take this strategy. Reach out to the army. Remember the army? Had 100,000 people in, tiny little army. The Nazis reach out to the army. They say, look, you know, if you help us get elected, we will expand military spending. We need to expand the army. Okay? Two, everyone here with the brown shirts? The brown shirts were these thugs that the Nazis had, a Sturmabteilung, SA we called them. And they were kind of a quasi-mob army that the Nazis put together in the 20s. Hitler reaches out to the military and says, you know what the other thing is? You want to get rid of these brown shirts? You support me, we'll do it. Okay? I will see to it that the brown shirts, because there have been talk among the brown shirts of taking over the military. That's not going to happen. And then he reaches out to the industrialists and he tells the bankers and the industrialists, you see how bad things are? You trust us. We will rebuild the German economy. Of course, anytime he was asked, well, how are you going to do it? Well, the will of the German people will do it. We will all do it together. Okay? So in 1930, you see Hitler starting to reach out to these big groups, second largest party in Germany, but they need to get that majority in parliament, right? The other thing is interesting, too. Like I say, the Nazi Party was one of the few parties that kept campaigning in 1930. Campaigning. They used speakers, megaphones on trucks. No one ever done that before. Hitler's the first one to fly in an airplane, for God's sake. He could be in Hamburg in the afternoon and Bavaria at night. No one ever seen all this. This is incredible. One of the tricks they used, and everyone ever hear of Joseph Goebbels? Goebbels was the propaganda minister from Hamburg. He came up with this idea. What you would do, if you came to a small town, or Heidelberg, for example, he said, you know what you got to do? Because in those days, you fill these big stadiums full. The communists did it. Everyone did it. Goebbels said, that's wrong. Go to Heidelberg, one of the smaller towns, and get the smallest stadium you can find, the beer hall. Find a beer hall. And what they would do, Tom Childers from the University of Pennsylvania says, one of their campaign things was to get these small beer halls and then have everyone there and feeding them beer. And it was almost like a rock concert. And Hitler would always show up late. Always had to show up late. And people would be in there, and you have people hanging from the rafters. I suppose if they sold T-shirts in that day, they'd be selling T-shirts. And at these political rallies, someone would come in and say, Der Führer has landed at the airport. And, oh, my gosh, the Führer has landed at the airport. And, of course, he'd be late. Show up, and people are just, oh, my gosh. And then pretty soon, half hour later, the Führer is on his way down the street. And oh my gosh, the Führer. And meantime, you got speakers, you know, really getting the crowd going. But they always made sure that they were small venues. And then Hitler would show up, maybe spend 15 minutes talking, then out the door, he'd go to the next thing. But they were masters of doing things like that. The Nazis were really the first political party that got it as far as going out and doing mass political campaigns. They got it. They understood. Okay. So in 1930, they are the second largest party, but they still don't have the numbers. They are attacking the Treaty of Versailles. What would happen? They would go in, a new government would be set up, and someone would make a motion to dissolve it, and they'd dissolve the government. Between 1930 and 31, Hitler is going from one end of Germany to the other, trying to concentrate his power. 1932 is going to be our breakthrough year. What happened in 1932? What's that? No, it's going to be in 33. 1932, remember Paul von Hindenburg, our general from World War I? He was the president of Germany. The way Germany had set up was you had a president, you had a chancellor. Chancellor ran the government, president was kind of the ceremonial head of Germany. That was Paul von Hindenburg. But his job was to appoint the chancellor, kind of like the queen does it in England. Okay? Hindenburg was old and sick. And in 1932, he was up for election. And everyone in the Reichstag, in the parliament, said, oh, we'll just re-elect the old guy. You know, he's kind of the grandpa to everyone in Germany. What the heck? Except one. Who was that? Hitler. Perfect. Hitler says, no. No, I'm going to run against him. I'm going to beat him. No, we want to just, you know, we'll just elect him. No. Hitler says, I'm running for president. So in the spring of 1932, Hitler runs for president. Hindenburg doesn't win. He wins, but he doesn't win a majority vote. There were three other people running, too. But Hitler got a lot of exposure on that campaign. So we have to do it a second time. Herr Hitler, come on, drop out of the race. Oh no, I'm going to be president. They have a second election. Hitler comes, doesn't beat Hindenburg, but gives him a scare. But Hindenburg's reelected. But what happened was Hitler is now able to go on a national scene and start talking about what he'd been talking about in the small places throughout Germany. He's on the national scene now. He's a national star. Okay? Meanwhile, the Nazis are gaining more seats in parliament. But they can't get a majority. It's frustrating. They cannot get a majority. And throughout the fall of 1932, they're pushing hard, trying to get a majority in parliament, and they can't do it. They go in, they vote, they dissolve the parliament. It was a joke. Under parliamentary rule, you can dissolve a parliament anytime you get a majority vote. Well, the communists and the Nazis would always vote together to dissolve the parliament. You could never get a government going. Then, in 1932, in the fall, they have one more election, November 1932. Okay? It's November 1932. They're going to have another election. And guess what happens? The Nazis lose. Yeah, they lost. And probably the biggest irony of history, in November 1932, the Nazis lose numbers. They lose seats. They lost 106 seats. Joseph Goebbels, the propagandist minister of the Nazi party, the chief of propaganda, says, oh my God, we blew it. We've lost numbers. Why did they lose numbers? Because the Nazis, everyone figures, was a protest vote. And you can only keep a protest vote together for so long. If you don't come to party power and do something, you lose votes. And that's what happened. They lost votes. Joseph Goebbels saying, we're never going to come to power now. We're losing votes. We lost seats. Okay? So how did Hitler become chancellor?
He was appointed by Hindenburg, was he not? I don't know if he formed a coalition before that or not.
Hitler, and does anyone want to take a break here? Okay, all right. I mean, if you do, just tell me. We'll take a break. Heck. Okay? 1932. Let's go back. November 1932, the Nazi party is losing votes. They've lost it. They're not coming to power. Joseph Goebbels, he writes in his diary, he's just having a heart attack. After all these years of campaigning, after all these years of going into parliament, we're not coming to power. We have lost our chance to run Germany. And then, by a stroke of luck, it changes. All right. So, we're up here, 1933. It's November, December of 1932. Hitler is beside himself. They just can't get over the hump to become a majority in parliament. They're never going to become chancellor. Goebbels is having a fit. And he gets a phone call. Paul von Hindenburg. Hindenburg and his deputy, Fritz von Papen, had decided that, look, Hitler keeps saying, if I come to power, I'm going to make change things. I will restore Germany to its greatness. Hindenburg, who's 85 years old, is thinking, you know what? Hitler keeps saying this, and I've had a series of chancellors who haven't been able to do beans. Maybe we should let him in. Maybe we should let him in the government. Let him take part in the government. He can't do any worse than anyone else. Okay. So they go to Hitler in December, end of December, first part of January 1933, Fritz von Papen and Hindenburg. And Hindenburg hated Hitler. But he figured, you know what, I can control him. I can control the other chancellors. He was this very imposing figure. And I can control Hitler. Fritz von Papen, his deputy, says, yep, we can control him. So they go to Hitler. They say to Hitler, here's the deal. You be vice chancellor. Fritz von Papen will be chancellor, bring you in the government. What do you say? Hitler says no. Joseph Goebbels about had a heart attack when Hitler turned him down. No, I'm going to be chancellor. And not vice chancellor, no, chancellor. I will be chancellor of Germany. Which, by the way, they had changed law because he's an Austrian, so they had changed law so they could. Von Hindenburg thinks about it. He consults von Papen, some of the other ministers, said, well, what do you think? Hitler keeps saying he can run the government. He said, let him in. Look, we can make him chancellor. We can control him like we controlled every other chancellor in Germany. So go make the deal. So in January 1933, Hindenburg goes back to Hitler and he says, okay, here's the deal. Chancellor, we'll let you be chancellor. Von Papen will be vice chancellor. What else do you want? Hitler says, look, give me chancellor. Give me chancellor. Von Papen can be the vice chancellor, your guy. Then I only want a couple other things. Hindenburg listens. What do you want? Hitler says, I just want the chancellor, right? And why not Minister of the Interior? I've got someone in mind from the Nazi party for that. Okay. And Minister of Prussia. Prussia was three-fifths of Germany, it was the big German state. That's all I want. You give me those three offices in the government, we're good. I don't care what you do with the rest of it. You can name socialists, conservatives, I don't care. Give me those three. Well, von Hindenburg thinks he can make this deal. He thinks he can make the deal, control Hitler, and if we have to, we get rid of him. So they make the deal. What von Hindenburg didn't know is he just made a deal with the devil. Here's why. Number one, Hitler's chancellor, right? Minister of the Interior. Does anyone know what the Minister of Interior of Germany did? They don't chase snail darters. Okay? They don't worry about elk numbers or water quality. The Minister of the Interior of Germany controls the German police. The Minister of Prussia, who will be Hermann Göring, controls the Prussian police. And Prussia is three-fifths of Germany. See what von Hindenburg has just done? He made a deal with the devil. And he didn't realize how bad he screwed up. They think they can control Hitler. They really can't. And on January of 1933, Hitler is appointed Chancellor of Germany with his three henchmen at the helm of the police. All right. Anyone want to take a break? Or should we keep going? Okay. How about 5 minutes? Okay, 10 minutes. June 30th, 1933, Hitler becomes chancellor. He is now the head of Germany. Wilhelm Frick is the head of the German police, the Minister of the Interior, as we talked about. And Hermann Göring is Reichsminister of Prussia. Important thing to remember, what do? They run the police. Okay. One of the first things Göring does when he becomes head of the police on February 22nd, he looks around and says, you know, we don't have enough police. We need more police. I know, I've got a great idea. Let's deputize the Nazi SA, remember the brown shirts? We'll deputize them and this new group we have called the SS, the Schutzstaffel, Nazi security police, we'll deputize them. We'll make them cops. So it wasn't unusual now to see a regular German policeman walking with an SS man. Because we have to. Because of public safety. And then on February 27th, into the night of morning of 28th, something happens that changes everything. The Reichstag burnt down. What happened was Marius van der Lubbe, he was kind of nutsy, had gone into the Reichstag, had taken kerosene, spread it all over, and set the place on fire. Marius van der Lubbe was from Holland, loosely attached to the Holland Communist Party, not really, he was a member, kind of, by proxy, but he really wasn't really a communist, per se. The Reichstag burns down. The German parliament, it burnt down. Now, some historians have claimed the Nazis did it. Because Hermann Göring would get drunk and write stories, would say things to people. Yeah, I remember we burnt down the Reichstag. They didn't burn down the Reichstag. Most historians now pretty much figure it was Marius van der Lubbe who burned it down. But the Nazis were now in power, said, look, it's the start of the communist revolution. Remember, I was just mentioning this gentleman here. The one thing the Nazis feared the most were the communists in Russia and Poland coming into Germany. They said, look, they burned down the parliament building. The revolution is coming. We need to do something. Joseph Goebbels tells Hitler, you need to do something. I'll write it up. And what he writes up is called the Reichstag Fire Decree. What did it do? It said, in Germany, number one, I'm declaring martial law. Remember Article 48? You get to do that, don't you? You go to Hindenburg, but he's going to give it to you. I'm declaring martial law. Number two, I am suspending all civil rights in Germany. This is a war. The communists are going into the streets. They're going to rebel. I suspend all civil rights in Germany. Right for trial? Gone. Okay? And he does. Our friends, the German police and the SS and the SA, who are now cops, they start rounding up anyone who's in opposition to the government and putting them in prisons. They start to build places like Dachau. Dachau is a concentration lager. Not a death camp, but a concentration lager. It's where you send political dissidents. I've been to Dachau. It's a very scary place even today. It's near Munich. Okay? Then Hitler says, you know what? We need to have more. We need to have another election. We're going to have a new election for parliament. We're going to have a new parliament. We've got a new government. We need a new government. And we need a new parliament. So in March 1933, they have another election. The election in 1933, in March, was probably the most crooked election you've ever wanted to have. People would come to vote. And remember, Germany's the size of Wisconsin, so it's a small area. People would come to vote, and Nazi officials would stand in line and say, oh, you're here to vote? Yes, are you going to vote for the new government? Well, I don't think so. Oh, don't worry, you don't need to vote. Why did you leave? We'll tell you how it turns out. And if you didn't, they would escort you. And despite how crooked the election was, the Nazis still couldn't win a majority in parliament. They still don't win a majority in parliament. They have to have a government with the conservatives to make it work. So on March 1933, they have a new election. We have a new parliament. What happens next? And by the way, despite all that the Nazis did in that election, they still only got 44% of the vote. On March 23rd, 1933, Hitler goes to the parliament and says, I need what's called the Enabling Act. What's the Enabling Act? The Enabling Act was a law that said, I get to rule by decree. Because of our emergency, remember the communists burnt down the Reichstag building, they're coming in from Russia and Poland, I need to rule by decree. You need to give me the power that what I say is going to be law. We need to do this for the security of Germany. And remember, Article 48 said I get to do this. Pass it. Now, this is how bizarre it got. In Parliament, the day it was passed, a lot of people would stand up and would talk against it. And then were taken outside and beaten. You've got these SS men all around the Parliament yelling and screaming. People are intimidated. Some people did vote against it. They saw where this was going. But it passes. The Enabling Act passes. Now Adolf Hitler is able to rule Germany by decree. Why? Because he needs to, because the revolution is coming. And for public safety, I have to rule by decree. It passed 441-84. Democracy was dead. And this is why I always tell people, you know, you got to be careful. When you have national emergencies, be careful what happens. Keep your eyes open on what happens next. Not that it would ever happen in this country. We have a completely different system, and I say that sincerely, given the fact of our last election. It probably wouldn't happen in this country because of the way we're set up. But I always tell people, be careful. Anytime we start talking about national emergencies, and I understand that happens, you have to do it. Keep your eyes open at all times, okay? All right. So, Hitler now is going to rule Germany by decree. What I say is the law. Parliament, you can give me some advice. What I say is law. Okay? It is now no longer a democracy. Then begins the actions against the Jews in earnest. The Nazis organized a national boycott of Jewish stores in the spring of 1933. It was a complete failure. People, you know, you've seen pictures of these big brown shirts sitting, standing by the doors of the shops, right? When, you don't need to come in here. Germans wouldn't stand for it. It was a complete failure. Why? Because I think one German Hausfrau said it the best. Ich kaufe meinen Butter, ich immer mein Butter kaufen. I buy my butter why I always buy my butter. It was a failure. So there were actions against the Jews during this period, but most of the time Hitler's trying to consolidate his power. Okay, he's trying to gather together and make his power absolute. The other thing that the German government does is always the good news. Always the good news. Everything is good in Germany. Right? Look, we have a new Autobahn. The Germans were first making an Autobahn, an interstate. Every German will get a German radio. Always the good news about the regime, which wasn't the truth, of course. You know, they said Nazi Germany was like a duck. You know how the duck on top of the water looks real calm? And you look underneath, the feet are going like this. That's what Nazi Germany was. It looked all order. It was chaos underneath. You had Nazi officials and you had government officials, and no one could figure out what the other one was doing. Okay, so this is a time where we start to see consolidation of government. Now, one thing Hitler's going to have to do is get rid of anyone who's against him. And that's going to come in the next year. You remember our friends, the brown shirts? They called one day. You're fine. Happens to me all the time. Wait till you do it in court sometime. All right. Let's talk about what happens when Hitler decides to consolidate party. And by the way, in July 1933, the Nazi Party is now the only official party in Germany. That was one of the laws he passed. So we get rid of that. All right. 1934. Remember our friends, the brown shirts? The brown-shirted thugs of the Nazi Party who wanted to be an army? Ernst Röhm was the head of the SA. Hitler needs support of the army, because the army's still a little, not sure about this guy. So he makes a deal with the army. On June 30th, 1934, because Ernst Röhm had said, yeah, we're going to be the army from now on, the brown shirts, he agrees that he will liquidate the brown shirts, the head of the brown shirts, the SA. That's the deal he made with the army to get their support in 1934. So he needs their support. He needs the army's support. What does he do on June 30th? Ever heard of the Night of the Long Knives, they called it? They liquidate the leaderships of the brown shirts. Ernst Röhm's shot. A lot of the head people of the brown shirts, the SA, are shot. Because what Hitler's saying to the army is, I'm supporting you guys. I'm getting rid of the brown shirts. You support me, I get rid of them. And he pays the price. Okay? In 1934, he's consolidating his party. He's getting rid of anyone who opposes him. There were only about 100 people were shot, but they were the leaders of some of the high Nazi party officials that he purged so he could get support of the army. What's he doing? He's consolidating his power. So now the army's going to support him. Probably would have, because Ernst Röhm was a liability to Hitler. He was a homosexual, and this is a time when, quite honestly, if you were gay, you were going to get sent to a concentration camp. And it really, we talk about the excesses against the Jews, and there were excesses against Jews, no question about that. But there are also excesses against homosexuals, Jehovah's Witnesses. If you were disclosed as gay, you were sent to a concentration camp. And sometimes they beat it out of you, so to speak. And Ernst Röhm might have gone that way. Ernst Röhm, who was an old Nazi official who headed the brown shirts, the thugs, kept saying in public that they were going to be the next German army. And the military didn't like that. Because by then the brown shirts were out around 1 million people. And the army is what, 100,000? They don't like Ernst Röhm saying things like that. So the price to get their support, Hitler has to get rid of them. And that's what he does. Okay? One of the strange things, And you gotta love the SS, the Gestapo, and we'll talk about the Gestapo in a second. Night of the Long Knives, right? They're getting rid of all political dissidents. They're getting rid of the brown shirts. They're going to liquidate the leadership. That's what they always called it. There was a, and I want to make sure I get the name right. Oh, here we go. Willy Schmid, we say in German, was a local brown shirt leader. Okay? Munich. So they go to his door, they send the German government sends an assassination team to kill him. Don't get rid of the brown shirts, right? Knock on the door, open the door, bang, shoot him in front of his wife. He falls down dead. How bad is that? It gets worse. You know what happened? This is how bad the Nazis were. They shot the wrong guy. This is Willy Schmidt, the music critic, who writes for the paper. And they just shot him in front of his wife. In fact, the German government gave her a pension the rest of her life. Because I'm really sorry we shot your husband. We thought he was a different guy. That's how bungling the Nazis were in some of their things. So, anyway. All right, so now Hitler is consolidating power. He's got the army behind him now. He paid the price, got rid of the brown shirts. The army is now supporting him. Now it's time to look outside of Germany. Okay, now, one thing you have to understand. When World War I ended, the Allies said, we want to have self-determination of national peoples. What does that mean? They came up with a policy that said, we want Poland for the Poles, Czechoslovakia for the Czechs, right? This was part of the Treaty of Versailles. It's in the treaty. Great. Hitler's now come to power, right? You know what he's going to say? We've got to bring all German people together. He would say they have to come Heims in the Reich. They have to come home to the German Reich. The grosses Deutsches Reich, the greater German Reich. He's using their own words against him, isn't he? For example, he looks south to Austria. Austria was an independent country, right? And in March of 1938, in the spring, 1938, he decides, I want Austria to become part of Germany. Of course, the Allies find out about this, and what can they say? What did they say? We want Poland for the Poles. Well, Hitler says, look, they're Germans. Austrians are Germans. They just want to come into the German Reich. Right? They're using the words the Allies used 20 years ago against them. So he meets with the Austrian Prime Minister. It's an interesting story in the spring when Dr. Schuschnigg, who was the Chancellor, comes to Germany. And they take him up to, do you know where the Eagle's Nest is? It's on top of this big mountain at Berchtesgaden. And they go up and up and up in this caravan. They get to the top, and there's this cave. It's a true story. There's this cave, and the Austrian Chancellor walks into this cave, and here are all these SS soldiers at full attention, dress uniforms, and he walks into a door. The room starts to move. The door closes, the room starts to move. Yeah, no, he's in an elevator. And he goes down to the bottom, door opens up, and there's Hitler with the German high command. And he's telling the Austrian Chancellor, you're going to unite us in Germany. You're going to come Heims in Reich. Going to come to the German Reich. And he's basically yelling at the Chancellor, Hitler is, you will come into the German Reich. You will be part of Germany because you are German. Okay? And behind him are the German generals. Now, the German generals are about ready to throw up. Literally. Because why? If they, Hitler's saying, we're going to march into Austria. If you don't do it, you're messing with the Germans who live there, the German Nazis. We're going to come into Austria. And the German generals are going, oh, my God. Because the German generals didn't want to go to war. They go into Austria, they're going to have another war with France and England. And the German generals are beside themselves. I mean, they don't show it. They're playing the old stone face. But they said later, our toes are turning here, folks. Because Hitler's threatening to take Austria, and we ain't going to be able to take Austria. Because if we march in, we're in war. And we don't have... How many people are in the German army? 100,000, plus minus. We're not going to win the war. And it's interesting, because Hitler just keeps pounding the table and pounding the table. Finally, Schuschnigg, who's the Austrian Chancellor, says, okay, fine. We'll join Germany, and he goes back to Austria, and he decides to have an election, have the people vote on him. Hitler's just ticked. He decides that he'll send troops into Austria to take Austria. They march in. And in March 1938, German troops enter Austria. Hitler's in the front of the lead, and the German generals are holding their breath. What's going to happen? We've just invaded a country. Well, that's where we're going. And what happens? The Allies don't do anything. They don't do anything. The French, the British, Russians, we won't count them because they're Soviet Union now. They don't do anything. You know why they don't do anything? They don't want war. They don't want war. Besides, the Austrians are Germans. Let them come Heims and Reich. That's what we said about the Czechs, right?
Was the movement of the Sudeten
Land prior to the... After. After the Anschluss. Yes.
Why didn't he take the brown shirts instead of the military?
Because they just liquidated the brown shirts in 1934.
Why did he liquidate them when there were so many more of them? He could have liquidated the army or you know, joined them in.
Because the brown shirts were a bunch of brown-shirted thugs. They were an army wannabe, basically. The Wehrmacht was a professionally trained army. And the Wehrmacht really said, if you want our support, Hitler, you've got to get rid of the brown shirts. The brown shirts are nothing more than thugs. They want to be an army, but you know, they're not a trained army. And you think you can attack a country with these guys in brown shirts? I mean, that's what the generals were telling Hitler. No, you need a professional army. That means you've got to call on the Wehrmacht.
What happened to the rest of the
They were either assimilated into the SS, which is another story, or they just joined the army. Some of them joined the army. But as an organization, it was dissolved. Some of them joined the SS, which is the Schutzstaffel, which we'll talk about here in a second. Okay.
Did he form any resistance
to Hitler at all? Nope. Nope, because Hitler's killed when you kill the head of the snake, there's not much left to fight. I mean, most of the brown shirts were thugs. I mean, they were criminals. They decided to go join the Nazis and beat up on communists. Okay? Good question though. All right. So, now we have the Anschluss. Austria's part of the Grosses Deutsches Reich. Well, if you say Germany and German enough, people actually think that, you know, that's something important.
You hinted that there was going to be an election in Austria. Did that ever happen?
The plebiscite was held after the Germans invaded. When Hitler found out that they were going to have a plebiscite, he invaded. Then they had a plebiscite, a public vote. Guess how it turned out? And which helped Hitler because he was able to say, look, we had a vote. And the same tactics they used in Germany a few years before, they used in Austria. So there was a vote. But of course, you know how it turned out. All right. The big thing, though, to remember about the Anschluss is there is no objection from the Allies. They don't want a war. And what the heck? They're Germans. They're coming in Heims and Reich to the Deutschland. Do we want to argue with that? We just gave Poland to the Poles. Okay? So what's next? The Sudetenland. Now, the Sudetenland was part of Czechoslovakia. It was on the mountainous region of Czechoslovakia, on kind of the rump end of it. And it's where most of Czechoslovakia had their military installations. If you invade Czechoslovakia, you had to go through the Sudetenland. Hitler starts cranking it up again. Look, the Sudeten Germans, the Germans who live in this part of Czechoslovakia, are being mistreated by Czechoslovakia. They're Germans. They need to come Heims and Reich to Deutschland. Remember, once again, you said the Czechs get their country. We want to bring the Germans into Germany. So what's the problem? Well, the Czechoslovakians had something to say about it. But again, you have a situation where instead of going to Czechoslovakians, Hitler is pushing hard to get the Sudetenland. And he's willing to take it by force. And again, the German generals are going, oh my gosh, this guy's crazy. That's going to cause a war. We're not ready for the war. Hitler pushes to get the Sudetenland. And in the meantime, cooler heads are trying to prevail. Chamberlain, who you talked about, was Prime Minister of England. And Benito Mussolini, of all people, are trying to broker a deal. Benito Mussolini is an ally of Hitler, but he's not ready to go to war. And he's really concerned that the Germans invade Czechoslovakia this time. There will be a war. So they decide to have a conference in Munich. And it's interesting. The French were there. Benito Mussolini was there. Hitler was there. The Brits were there. Chamberlain. In September 1938, they meet in Munich. And it is agreed that Czechoslovakia will give the Sudetenland to Germany. The trouble was, the Czechs weren't there. Nor were the Russians. We had a professor at Black Hill State when I was a kid, Stephen Gazi. No, no, you guys don't remember Dr. Gazi. He was a Serbian. No, he was a Bosnian. But he was a member of the Czechoslovakian foreign delegation. He was there when this happened. And he said they would not let us into the negotiation hall. It was the French, the British, and the Italians who negotiated that treaty. And what did they do? They gave the Sudetenland to Hitler. Hitler says, this is all I want. You give us the Sudetenland, give us our good Germans back to the Reich, I'm good. No more territorial demands. Well, Chamberlain gets back to Britain, and he holds up this piece of paper, which actually it's not the exact treaty. It was a kind of a side treaty, saying this is peace in our time. And you know what? Everyone applauded him. I mean, everyone applauded him. Why would you go to war over this chunk of land in Czechoslovakia that no one can't even find on a map and start a world war over that? Most people in Britain and France saluted Chamberlain. Said, this is great. We avoided war. Well, they were wrong. Hitler then moves into Prague a few months later and takes over the rest of Czechoslovakia. And again, what did the Allies do? Nothing. They want peace so bad, because World War I's still in the back of their minds, that they do nothing. Okay? Hitler's kind of stretching. He says, I'm just bringing the good Germans back into the German Reich. Well, there were a few Germans in the rest of Czechoslovakia, but the Czechs couldn't do anything because they'd already given up the Sudetenland. And that's where they had all their defense constellations. So now Hitler has annexed Czechoslovakia. All right. I'm going to fast forward real quick. You guys have listened to me for 2 hours, and you are great. Yes. No. Good point. During this time, Hitler starts to induce conscription into the German army. Violation of the Treaty of Versailles. You can't have more than 1,000 men. He starts in 1934 to draft Germans into the army. The army's starting to grow. It's not quite there yet, but it's starting to grow. The other thing he did in 1934, Luftwaffe. Under the treaty, Germany was not supposed to have an air force. In 1934, he abrogates the treaty and starts building a Luftwaffe. A German Air Force. What do the Allies do? Nothing. Do you want to go to war over whether you can have an Air Force or not? Everyone's got an Air Force. What the heck? I mean, that was their idea. People were so sick of war from World War I, they weren't going to go to war over whether Germany had an Air Force. Who cares if they have an Air Force? Well, they're short-sighted, not long-sighted. Okay? All right. Moving ahead. 1939, Germany is now going to turn east again to Poland. Now, Hitler, in July of 1939, tells his army, get ready, we are going to go to war on this one. He wanted to go to war over Czechoslovakia, but the Allies backed down. And the German generals say, you know, you're really pushing it. I mean, we're starting to put an army together, but we need time. We can't, you know, France has the largest army in Europe. They declare war on us, you know, we can't guarantee anything. Hitler cranks it up again. Here's what he does. He makes demands on Poland. Same story all over again. In the summer of 1939, he says to the Poles, here we go again. That part of was Germany before World War I, it's in Poland now. You guys are mistreating Germans, German nationals. You're mistreating the German nationals in Poland. We can't have this. Let them come to the German Reich. They're Germans. What the heck? You know what? Again, he throws it back in the Allies' faces. You said Czechoslovakia is Czech. Well, these are just Germans in Poland. You know, let them come Heinzenreich to the German Reich. Okay. The Allies, and Hitler tells his advisors, I know how they work. They're going to back down. Von Ribbentrop is foreign minister. They'll back down. You've dealt with them before. They've never stood up to us yet. We've got Austria, Sudetenland, and Austria. They're not going to stand up to you. They're going to back off. So throughout the summer of 1939, Hitler starts making demands on the Poles. Von Ribbentrop guarantees him, the Allies will not do anything. We'll do the same thing we did in Czechoslovakia. Okay? Demands on the Poles. Hitler also tells the military, which has grown by now, to prepare plans to invade Poland. But they needed one more piece of the puzzle to make it work. throughout the summer of 1939 into August, the German foreign ministry is working feverishly. What are they doing? Can anyone tell me? What's that?
Are they trying to make a deal with the Soviet Union?
Perfect. They've got to come up with a treaty with the Soviet Union. Because what the Germans had decided by that summer was, if we invade Poland, and if the British and French declare war on us, we can't have a two-front war. That's what killed us in World War I. We had fought the Russians and we fought the West. We need to come up with some type of agreement with the Soviet Union that would prevent us from fighting that two-front war. And in August 1939, von Ribbentrop meets with Molotov, the USSR's foreign minister, and they start to negotiate. Now, why would Stalin want to negotiate with a Nazi? He's communist, right? Why would he want to negotiate anything with Hitler? Hitler's a fascist. He's a communist. Why would Stalin negotiate? Well, a couple things. Go ahead. That was a good chunk of it. Stalin, you got to know a little bit about Stalin. This was a time in the world history when we had a bunch of nuts running the country. Stalin was a Georgian, actually. Very paranoid. He had purges in 1935-36 that took out most of the officers in the Russian army, the Soviet army. He didn't trust the West. Because if you look at the direction Hitler's going, to Czechoslovakia, and now he's pushing against Poland, and the Allies aren't doing anything. What are they actually doing, Stalin said? They're pushing Hitler right towards the Soviet Union. And we know Hitler's an anti-communist, so we know, according to Stalin's thought, we know what the Allies are doing. They're pushing Hitler towards us. We're going to be the next on the table, and the Allies ain't going to do beans. We don't trust them. Stalin didn't trust them. He thought for sure that's what the game plan was. And he could get some little dealings here, too. So in the summer of 1939, he's negotiating with the Nazis in Germany to come up with a treaty that, number one, would steer the Germans away from him. It's called a non-aggression pact. And number two, there was a secret part to the agreement. That agreement said, if the Germans invade Poland, they would go halfway. The Soviet Union would invade from the east. And the Soviet Union would be allowed to occupy eastern Poland as their sphere of influence. Secret negotiation. No one knew about that part of the treaty except Stalin or the Germans and the Russians. And in August 1939, they signed the treaty, the non-aggression pact between the Soviet Union and Germany. The Allies were stunned. Part of it was the Allies' fault. They had a chance to negotiate, and they just kind of blew off Stalin. But they were stunned. Now the Soviet Union and fascist Germany have come to an agreement that they're not going to attack each other. Okay.
Did the Polish corridor have anything to do with
right.
that?
Right. After World War I, there was the Polish corridor. Parts of the League of Nations wanted to guarantee that Poland had a seaport, Danzig, which was actually a German port. So they gave part of Germany, and then they did this corridor to connect it to Germany, and the Poles got the port. Germans hated it because they considered that German territory. Yes, that's very true and a good point. But in August 1939, if you're sitting there in Parliament in Britain or in Paris, and you just found out that the Soviet Union, the anti-fascist force of the world, has just signed a non-aggression treaty with Germany, the fascist, an anti-communist group, you'd have been stunned. You would never seen it coming. So in August 1939, we have now signed a non-aggression treaty between the Soviet Union and Germany. Germany's not going to fight a two-front war. And now Germany ramps up the pressure on Poland. Give us our Germans, the corridor. Give them back to the Reich. Let those Germans come. Heinz in the Reich. The Poles tried to negotiate, but Hitler really wasn't in a negotiating mood. Why should he? The Allies aren't going to do anything. Look what we did in Austria. Look what we did in Sudetenland. Look what we did in Czechoslovakia. What did they do? Nothing. On August 25th, 1939, the German army was given orders to attack Poland. It was called off at the last minute. In fact, there's a record, the German army records show that they celebrated. The German army, even though they had more troops, they really didn't want to go to war. And in fact, there's at one of the, I think it was Hans Guderian's headquarters, when it got called off, they popped champagne. They were so happy they didn't have to go to war. They were worried. But on August 30th and 31st, it was called back on. What the Germans did was took inmates from Dachau, dressed them up in Polish army uniforms, took them out to a radio station near the German border, shot them, and then reported that the German army was under attack by the Polish army, that this radio station had been attacked. Look, there's the Polish paratroopers' bodies right there. The German army was responding. And thus began the invasion of Poland. Now, the story is that von Ribbentrop, Hitler's in the chancellery, and this, and it's supposedly a true story. He is sure the Allies aren't going to do anything. Why? Because they've never done anything before, right? And in a few days, the Russians are going to attack from the east. On September 3rd, Britain and France declare war on Germany. And supposedly, Hitler calls von Ribbentrop into his chancellor office and say, now what? You guaranteed us that they would not declare war. They have. Now what? And German army, the British tried to negotiate. They said, look, we'll negotiate. You got to get your troops out. Hitler refused. He thought he could refuse. He could afford to refuse it. But he is upset with von Ribbentrop because Ribbentrop guaranteed the Allies would not declare. It won't do anything. And he was wrong. 4 days later, the Russians invade from the east, and within 6 weeks, the Polish state ceases. It's over. Poland is now occupied, and World War II is about to begin. Okay. You've been here 2 hours, and you have been very, very patient with me. Thank you.
Why the Jews?
Why the Jews? That's, if you want to stay, we'll get into why the Jews. I just want, if anyone needs to leave or something like that, you're welcome. I want you to stay, but understand, you know, it's 8:30, for God's sakes.
Germany.
Here's what, interesting question. Okay, the Russians signed a non-aggression treaty with the Germans, right, in 1939. By 1940, if you remember your World War II history, the French and the British were off the continent. Britain at Dunkirk almost got wiped out. By the summer of 1940, there are no troops, British troops on the continent. France surrenders in June of 1940. So Hitler's gotten rid of his Western war, hasn't he? That's gone. Hitler was always going to attack the Soviet Union. No question. It's just when. So what he does then is he waits until June of 1941. Over 1.5 million men will attack the Soviet Union from Germany, including my uncle on my mom's side. He's gotten rid of the British. The British are nothing. I mean, they're hanging on, but just barely. The French have surrendered. There's no other Western front. So now it's time to turn your attention to the Soviet Union. And in June 1941, he will attack the Soviet Union in the largest military operation in the history of mankind. He will try to, he will use the Blitzkrieg, and we can talk about what the Blitzkrieg is, to attack with three giant army groups, to attack Leningrad, Moscow, and the south through the Ukraine. You know, they always said Hitler planned to destroy the Soviet Union. It's just a question of when. The non-aggression pact was just to buy time and get rid of this Western front. And when he defeated the French in 1940 and the British in 1940, he got rid of it. Now he can attack the Soviet Union in 1941. And that was his plan. Yeah, you look to the east like we look to the west. All right, finally, I'm going to talk briefly about the Holocaust. I want to bring to your attention a speech that Hitler gave on January 30th, 1939, the sixth anniversary of his ascension to the chancellorship. This is a quote. This was on January 30th, 1939. Hitler said, "One thing I should like to say on this day, which is memorable for others as well as for us Germans. In the course of my life, I have been a prophet, and I have been ridiculed for it. During the time of my struggle for power, it was the first instance the Jewish race only received my prophecies with laughter when I said that I would one day take over leadership of the state, and with it, that of the whole nation, and that I would, among other things, settle the Jewish problem. Their laughter was uproarious, but I think that for some time now they've been laughing on their side of, side of their face. Today I will be a prophet once more. I will once more be a prophet. If international Jewish financiers in outside Europe should succeed in plunging the nation once more into world war, the result will not be the Bolshevization of the earth, and thus victory for Jewry, but annihilation of the Jewish race in Europe." Close quote. That's the speech he gave to the Reichstag on January 30th, 1939. Hitler was anti-Semitic, no question about it. Anti-Semitism is just a fancy word for the German word Judenhass, which means hatred of Jews. Hatred of Jews has been around for centuries, unfortunately. You can go back to the Middle Ages. Why did they hate Jews in the Middle Ages? They're heretics. Yeah. One, they were the killers of Christ. I always point out, you know, the Italians had something to do with that, too. Two, they were non-believers. What do you call a non-believer? It's a heretic. What do you do with the heretics in the Middle Ages? You kill them, you burn them, you get rid of them. So that's kind of where we get some of this anti-Semitism. Jews had a tendency to live in their own communities, had their own traditions. A lot of rumors about some of the Jewish traditions. You know, in the Middle Ages, they thought they were sacrificing Christian children, for example, in their blood rituals. Well, it wasn't true, but it was enough to get thousands of Jews killed. They ran the finances. You know why Jews got a lot of Jewish individuals went into financing? What's that?
They couldn't own any land.
Kind of.
You couldn't charge interest, right?
Right, exactly. The Pope had an edict in the Middle Ages that said Christians cannot charge another Christian interest. It was a sin. Tell that to your banker, right? You can't charge me interest. Pope said it was a sin. Jews are not Christians. Do they have to listen to the Pope? No. So that's why a lot of them in the Middle Ages went into financing. Okay. Then there was this crazy notion in the turn of the century that somehow the Jews are trying to take over the world, the protocols of the elders of Zion, through the financing. They were going to take over the world. Conspiracy theories abounded. So when World War I ends, remember our old friend the Dolkstall stabbed in the back? It was obviously the Jews. This is how they were going to take over the world. So that's why you see this focusing on the Jews. Initially in 1933, there were boycotts, there were laws. But really Hitler spends the first couple years of his regime trying to consolidate power. In 1935, he passes what were called the Nuremberg Laws. And there were three. Go ahead.
I don't know if I can get all three of them, but...
You got to say it in German.
I can't say it in German.
Okay. I can't either. Yep. Or have relations with a Jew.
Right. Okay. Only
one
I know.
Okay. And that's very good. There were three Nuremberg laws. Every September, you'd have this big party meeting in Nuremberg. And in 1935, Hitler was going to give this speech on foreign policy. As Hitler often did, he changed his mind. So the night before, he's going to give this speech on the Jewish situation. And a lot of his aides were literally writing things on napkins because he wanted this speech tomorrow. At 1935 Nuremberg rally, he announces three laws against the Jews. One, Jewish blood. Someone who is a non-Jew cannot marry or have relations with a Jew. Two, establish the Nazi swastika as a national flag. And three, and this was the big one, Jews in Germany were no longer citizens of Germany. They were subjects. What's the difference? We can govern you over if you're a subject, but you don't have any rights. Starting in 1935 and 1936, begins the expulsion of the Jews from Germany. Here was official German policy. You can leave. We want you to leave. We expect you to leave. We'll help you leave. But you got to leave your property behind. Yeah, you can't take your property. And your bank accounts, you can't take that. That goes to the German Reich. Okay? Yes?
Was it part of the Nuremberg Laws where they identified the definition of a Jew outside of the standard, like your practice, your religion, by blood?
Very good. There was always an issue in the Third Reich. Who was a Jew? Who's a Jew? Were you a Jew? No, I don't know. So they'd have these crazy meetings and come up with regulations, and you had to identify who was a Jew. And they finally agreed, and I believe it was in 1937, they came up with this idea, we got it figured out. A Jew is anyone who has one Jewish grandparent. If you had one Jewish grandparent, you were a Jew. And for government purposes, you'd be required to wear the star. Okay? Hitler could have been one. We don't know. But they spent hours in ministries and bureaucracies in Berlin just trying to figure out who's a Jew. And as you can imagine, you know, we have Ancestry.com. In Germany in those days, those kind of businesses made fortunes because no one wanted to be a Jew. My mother's sister, I've got the documents at home in Sturgis, when she went to teach school, she had to fill out the form to show that she was not a Jew. I mean, that's how crazy this got. Okay? The problem with the expulsion policy was, okay, where do you go? Do you leave Germany? Okay, I'll leave Germany. Where do I go? They had a conference in Evian, France in 1937, where no one would take more Jews. The United States said, well, we've got quotas. We can't take Jews. The Brits said, well, we can't take more Jews, we have quotas. So while the expulsion policy of Germany was the official policy of the German government, the Jews really had no place to go, because no one would take them. Palestine, that's a British-occupied country. No, you're not going there. It starts to ramp up, going into the war is where it really starts to ramp up. Because in Germany, there were 322,000 Jews. In the Soviet Union and Poland, there were millions of Jews.
Your call will be disconnected.
Thank you. So, to answer...
This recording has started.
Thank you. 1941, it's so polite. In 1941, they come up with the final solution, and I'll be brief here. Okay. Einsatzgruppen were liquidating people. They were shooting them. It didn't work. It was too public. So we have to come up with a final solution. And they do it at the suburb of Wannsee in Germany. January 1942, actually. It's supposed to be 1941. It got moved back to 1942. The head of the Nazi parties. The big dogs weren't there. Reinhard Heydrich was there. Adolf Eichmann was there. And they were going to come up with a final solution.
You are the only participant in the conference.
It was probably one of fascinating lady. If you ever get a chance to read a book, read a book. She was a twin that was taken to Auschwitz and pulled off the train. But what they would do is they had these huge gas chambers. I think there were three in Auschwitz at Birkenau. Three or four?
I think there's four.
And you could get up to 1,000 people in these things. And the ones I've seen, the designs I've seen, were you'd bring them in, and the Germans had figured it out. They had each square foot where you could put someone. I mean, they built them so you get 1,000 people in at once. Get them in, going to take a shower. You know, you've had a long trip. Take your clothes off. Men, women, children, put in the showers. They weren't showers. Lock the doors. Then someone on top would put in And what I've seen is the chicken wire column type things coming down. And they put Cyclone B in there. Everyone know what Cyclone B is? Hydrogen cyanide. And becomes a poisonous gas upon contact. And people would scream, and they'd throw themselves against the door. They'd try to get a fresh air, and they couldn't. 15 minutes, they'd be dead. They'd open up the gas vents on top, the gas get out, and you take the bodies out. Yeah, simple, efficient. You had concentration camps like Mauthausen, and you had death camps too. Very distinct, but they all ended up doing the same thing, unfortunately. 7.2 million, would I be right on that number, disappeared?
It's actually estimated to be higher because they didn't record everyone that came off the train. If you were really young or really old, you were automatically sent before even being registered into the camps. So it's actually high, probably closer to 13.
Okay.
Why would they bother having them register if they just kind of...
Because they were useful for labor for the most part, and that's where the big definition or the distinction between labor camps and the death camps. Death camps, like you said, were specifically designed for killing. But in the meantime, you still had political prisoners, you still had Polish workers, Jews that were able to work, and they would put them to work.
For example, Auschwitz is split into several camps. Birkenau, the death camp. Auschwitz had an IG Farben chemical plant that they worked you. They'd register you. And the other thing is, and this really at Nuremberg worked for the Allies, was Germans like to keep records. They're very tied into that kind of stuff. You would climb the stairs to heaven and then be a parachute troop. Mauthausen is where they climb the stairs up the quarry and then throw them off. Yeah. I'm going to end it this way. You guys have been very patient. I sure appreciate it. I'll end it this way. And this isn't my quote. It's a quote from another professor. When we look back on German history during this time, and when the Germans came out, say, in Berlin in 1945, and they looked around, and they saw what was left of Berlin. They had to say, how did this happen? And I'll tell you how it happened. And Joseph Goebbels said this, the propaganda minister. He said, we will do it with the Wurst theory, he said. You take a little slice of the Wurst every time. Just a little slice. People don't argue. They don't care. You take a little more slice. A little more. Soon, we'll have the entire sausage. Another person who survived the war from Germany said, you know, when they took our freedoms away, it's kind of like driving by corn. You drive by corn to work here. Oh, there's corn. Next day you drive by, oh, the corn's got a little taller. And then one day, about 3 months later, you drive by the corn and go, holy cow, look how big the corn's got. But you never notice it. And I honestly think the Germans thought that they were being protected, that they're willing to give up their freedom for security. Fully appreciate sometimes that happens. No one wants us to be in an unsafe world. But be careful when they start talking about taking away your freedoms. And I know we've been hearing about the CIA going into our microwave ovens. I haven't figured that one out yet. I don't trust my refrigerator, though. I'm being facetious. But it is a good point. I mean, everyone wants to be safe. No question about that. But when you start giving up a little bit of freedom every time, you know, forewarned is forearmed. And we need to take our lesson from history, from the Germans. Okay? Questions? Okay.
And then, were they ever caught and prosecuted?
Good question. First, you know, the SS is the ones who initially came up with the death camps. And they were You understand, the SS, the Nazi Party, actually became funded by the federal government. And they were able to come up with the plans for the death camps. They also, along with the German government, came up with the idea for Dachau, Buchenwald, these concentration camps, which were supposed to be re-education. The difference between a death camp and a concentration camp is that at least you thought you had a chance of getting out. For example, I've been to Dachau. In Dachau, you were sentenced to a term. We were going to re-educate you. You know, communists, Jews, homosexuals. We re-educate you. We'll sentence you to 3 years, and maybe you can get out early if we re-educate you. What's that? Arbeit macht frei, yep. Which was kind of ironic, because all they did was going to work and kill you. And that was at Auschwitz. Dachau had small ovens, but it wasn't quite like Auschwitz. But the idea was, we're going to take anyone who dissents and re-educate them in the concentration camps. Now, if you spend even 2 weeks in the concentration camp, you would be re-educated. We went on a tour, and they took us through it, and the things they would do, I mean, they'd grab you off a bus, they'd throw you into or off a truck and throw you into the education building, start shaving your head. It was horrendous what they did. They went in, they had this long penal building. I remember I walked into the penal building at Dachau. Now, I don't believe in ghosts, and, you know, I get it. But you walk into that penal building and you look down that long row of cells, it's still the way it was in 1933. I'm telling you, there's something there. I don't know what it is. Like I said, I'm not saying it's a ghost. But there is a feeling you get when you walk into that building. It's just strange. And you walk by all these cells where people were killed. But, yes, to answer your question, the purpose of concentration camps were to re-educate people and eventually release them. You could get out of a concentration camp, not out of a death camp. They're either going to take you to labor site and work you to death or kill you right away. They'd line you up, old men or old children, old men, old women, on this side, workers on this side. If you went this way, you might be worked to death, but you have a chance to live. If you went this way, you went right to the gas chambers. It's very devious. You know, and the funny thing is, a lot of people argue Germany lost that war because they contributed so much war material to running the concentration camps and the death camps. And they could have used it for the army.
There is an interesting thing that my mom said. I was actually born in Heidelberg, so she was stationed there in the late 80s, and she said that the neighbors that she lived with, the gentleman worked for he was in the German army, he was drafted into the army, and he said one of the things was he heard about all these things, he heard about the stories of the deportations in the camps, but to some degree, it was so outlandish of a thing that he was like, no, that's impossible. There's no way something like that could happen. And so I think education and learning the facts for yourself is hugely important going forward and relating it to lessons from the buildup of the Nazi power.
Yeah, a lot of Germans had heard stories about resettlement in the East. The Jews had heard about resettlement in the East. But a lot of people didn't believe it in Germany. I mean, no, come on. They just sent them east to resettle in the East. Interesting enough, the American government knew about Auschwitz as early as 1944. But the question Roosevelt had to face, do you bomb the camps, destroy them, or you try to get the war over as fast as you can and save lives? And really, that's the issue he debated. And it was debated. They had photos of Auschwitz. Our aerial group, the 12th Air Force, was able to take photos of Auschwitz in 1944. But the question was, number one, how do you get there to liberate them? The Americans were still stuck in France. Do you bomb the camps with the 12th Air Force and kill more people? Or do you try to end the war? And Roosevelt comes on the side of trying to end the war. I don't think he wanted on his conscience that he would murder innocent people by bombing them. Hard decision. Any other questions for me in for tonight?
How many camps did you say there were all the time?
There were seven death camps.
Seven.
Yeah, but they had sub camps, they had smaller camps, work camps. So there were seven death camps.
So what
Sobibor, Kelmo, Auschwitz-Birkenau, Majewitz, Majewitz? What's that? Bergen-Belsen was not. Maybe there were only five. Yeah, but that was concentration camp. Bergen-Belsen was concentration camp. Questions? Yes, ma'am. Well, yeah. I mean, it's still happening. I mean, genocide is something we will fight. In Syria right now is happening. In Iraq is happening. But from our side of the picture, Germany was the perfect storm. They had the perfect system that gave rise to their parliamentary system was terrible. It was horrendous. Number one, it didn't take much to bring the government down. Vote no confidence, didn't have government. You could never have, you had a lot of Fruit Loop groups that got into parliament, if you will, because you only need 60,000 votes and you're a member of parliament. It wasn't hard to get. The press was suppressed. Like I said earlier, anytime you start taking away freedoms, we got to be careful, even if it's in the name of national security. Because the Reichstag fire decree gave Hitler the power to suspend rights in Germany and got rid of all opposition as far as papers and everything. So we have to be very, very careful there. Could it happen in the United States? No, I don't think so, because our system is different. And I'll tell you why. Number one, the president is elected. Number two, we separate our powers pretty evenly with legislature, executive, and judiciary. They didn't have that in Germany. They really didn't. Four, Germany, you've got to remember, Germany is a small country, the size of Wisconsin. So there's not a lot of diversity in Germany at this time. I mean, yeah, you had the communists, you had the Nazis, you had the conservatives, but they're pretty homogeneous. Can you imagine you tried to do some of this stuff with New York and South Dakota and California and Texas in the mix? I think a lot of the parliamentary acts that were passed under Hitler, it'd never go. We're too diverse. So, but the big thing is watch your freedoms. Be careful. Yeah, you know, presidents say a lot of things. And I'm not trying to be facetious, but yeah. The press has brought some of it on themselves, but really, we do need a free press. We really do. I mean, to call it as they see it. And I just wish they'd be fair sometimes.
How many states are enacting protest laws?
I don't know. I know South Dakota has.
I think it's like on the order of 13.
Okay. I just know South Dakota passed theirs, was signed by the governor today. Okay. And remember, protest is protected under the Constitution. Peaceful protest is protected under the Constitution, the right to redress your government. Didn't have that in Germany. You had Article 48 that gave the president the right to suspend human rights. And they said that's one of the problems Germans had. They were so used to it by the time Hitler gets to power. So, suspended rights, who cares? And the other thing was, and I was talking to the gentleman here, the Germans were very much afraid of the communists. And you got to remember, the Soviet Union was established in 1919, 1920 and 21 and 22, right next door to Germany. Karl Marx is a German, you know that. So there was this big fear that the Russians, the Marxists, are going to come into Germany. And they did for a while. They took over Berlin for a while. So that was a fear, big fear. Lenin was a... Lenin, I think... No, I don't think Lenin was. For some reason. He was going to be... No, because Lenin was going to be a priest of all things.
Oh, really?
And he dropped out. Yep. I don't know about Marx.
Yeah, he was. I visited his birthplace in Trier.
Okay.
Many years ago. And there was an indication in the museum that now stands there.
Okay.
That he was a Jew. Of course, he died in England.
Right. He was poor as a pauper. Any other questions? Yes?
Yes, I've been hearing lately that there's a lot of drugs and they gave a lot of them to the soldiers.
Well, I've heard several stories. One thing is that methamphetamine was actually developed by the Germans during the war. I've heard that story. I've never been able to verify it, but I have heard the story. And the Stahlhelm and the steel helmets. Hitler, at the end of his life in 1945, Most agree he had Parkinson's. And then his medical doctor was a quack. Shot him up with amphetamines. He was given all kinds of goofy treatments, but he was basically hooked on amphetamines at the end of the war. He had Parkinson's. Hitler, if you watch his last, he died in the end of April. If you watch the last of his videos, I think we've all seen the videos where he's congratulating the Hitler youth. If you look closely, his hands are really shaking. And so most historians think he might have had Parkinson's at that point. Hitler had several assassination attempts, but I think he was starting to show the Parkinson's and some of the outbursts he'd have during staff meetings with the generals. He'd just say crazy things. He would tell the generals, you have got to, during the bulge, we're gonna have these new jets out to you, and you're gonna have all these tanks. And it was all fantasy. I mean, by 1944, Hitler has pretty much gone off the deep end between the Parkinson's and the drugs. He's making promises. He's making decisions for the army. But the generals don't stand up to him. The generals don't stand. In fact, Erwin Rommel, what's that? Feldmarshal Rommel, who was one of the best generals they had, in the fall of 1944, tries to stand up to Hitler. They have a meeting in June saying, you know what? He tells them, we need to come up with a way to come to peace. And Hitler goes off on Rommel. You will shut up and you will confine your remarks to the war. And then Rommel gets shot up. And Rommel is eventually assassinated by the SS. Yeah. Long story, it's assassination attempt in July of 1944. Rommel had made the wrong statements that he might support a new government. Well, got back to the SS. And they put him in the back of a car and he had to take cyanide or they were going to kill his family.
Now, speaking of the SS, Hitler was one of the great proponents of the master race.
Yeah.
Take a look at that guy. He does not look like he's a member of the
master. He's a chicken farmer, for God's sakes. One more.
So I know that a lot of the anti-Semitism started out around 1938, 1939, started branching out. So how huge was the Night of Broken Glass? Was it a very huge event, or was it kind of a...
It was a big event. She's talking about Kristallnacht. In 1938, a young Jew whose parents were between Poland and Germany, and they couldn't get into either country, because neither country would take him. He gets frustrated, goes to Paris, and he's going to shoot the German ambassador to Paris. Well, he shoots a man named von Roth, who wasn't the ambassador, he was the secretary. But immediately, the Nazis get a hold of that and turn it into a propaganda machine. And what the Nazis tell, what Goebbels tells the police is, November 1938, they're going to start smashing windows, hence the term Night of Broken Glass, burning synagogues, murdering people. Police, you stand by. Just let them do it. And this was this popular uprising. And I can't remember how many people were killed, over 100, I think. But the damage they did was unbelievable.
Did that actually begin in Fürth, outside of Nuremberg?
What's that?
Kristallnacht.
Did
that start in Fürth?
It sure could have. So, thank you, guys.